Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Today we have an awesome, gorgeous, beautiful, stunning, super successful guest. We have Nikki Walton. She actually has the number one daily podcast in spirituality. She is amazing. And she actually recently did a big fruit fast and a juice fast as well. And she's been incorporating more raw into her life and noticing massive changes. She's incredible. And she actually used to work for Dr. Oz. She was on The Breakfast Club, one of my favorite podcasts. And just always accomplishing so much. So let's get into it. Let's find out how those fasts were going and have a great spiritual talk today. Hey, Nikki, how's it going?
I am blessed and I'm very thankful to be here with you. You are a star and have definitely been guiding me along this path, even if you did not know it yet. You do now. But it's been a journey. Like, I believe it's, I can't even tell you how many times I've tried to go specifically raw vegan since 2005. 2005, I threw out everything in the refrigerator, everything in the pantries. I cleaned out the house, all the snacks, and bought lettuces and vegetables and fruit. And that was it, and nuts. And I tried to just go. Like, it was completely intuitive. I hadn't read anything. I hadn't saw anything. It was just like, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. Everyone around me thought I was crazy. And within 2 or 3 days, I felt like I had the flu. And I thought I was crazy too. So I'm like, okay, I went back to eating some of the heavier, greasier, comforting things, and those symptoms left. So I thought, well, maybe this is what my body wants. And then of course, spirit moves again. And a few months later, I'm back to trying, get sick again, quit again. And this was my cycle. This was what I was doing pretty much up through 2018, 2019. During that time, I went vegan, but not raw vegan for more than a year, but I was doing it the unhealthy way. I was eating the fake meats and, I mean, like, they have like fake bratwurst. I was doing all of that stuff. And I did end up in the ER with a super high heart rate and super low blood pressure, but all of my vitals looked great. And so they told me, oh, you must have, like, you know, heavy menstruation. You're of that age. You need to eat meat and eat that, whatever this diet is you're doing. And these fake meats, of course, are bad. So just go eat real good meat and you'll be fine. And so I started eating fish again, and I never felt good about it. I don't even like the taste of chicken. So it was just really hard. And my spiritual journey has just gone deeper and deeper and deeper. I've been all over the world with the journey, but the presence that I feel even right now here with you is the same that I found in India, the same that I find in Israel, which I just, I'm going back to right now as well. It's the same presence, and it moves me to do it again. And so this time it didn't just move me to quit all of the foods that were harming me. It brought me the information. And so It brought me you, but first it brought me Dr. McDougall and the starch diet and kind of focusing less on fat, which is what my whole life had been focused on because I've always been so underweight. You know, they're like, you need more fat, you need more meat in your diet. Let's, you know, get some meat on those bones. And so finding his teachings, that book opened the door to all the other teachings. And then I found you and all the teachers that you share. And I bought probably 10 books in the last few months and just completely changed my life because now what I'm doing is sustainable. I feel alive and not weakened. And so for months I was doing pretty much raw vegan, like 90% raw. I might still do some steamed roots, you know, every now and then and some steamed veggies. But I started feeling like more called to fruit only. And so I was doing that for a couple of weeks, just fruit, smoothies, whole fruits, some juicing. And then the juicing felt so light and so natural. I just ended up in a juice fast. So it was one day of juice fasting, and then it was 2 days, and it was 3 days. And I'm like, how long are we going? And I went to 5 days. But I'll tell you, that second day I woke up with so much energy that I actually exercise. Like, that's one thing. I'm very busy. I run that daily show you were talking about so sweetly. Thank you.
Yeah.
And I just don't get time with everything going on in my life. I don't take great care of this human body at all. Like, it's almost the last priority. And that's what I've been working on lately. So I don't usually exercise. So to be like, oh, I'm going to get on the treadmill today. I got on the treadmill. I went hard. And by that night, I'm like, I was feeling like I went too hard. You know, everything was achy. And then I'm like, I'm getting a fever. And it flashed me back to 2005 and then 2007 and 2010, all those times I had tried to go raw vegan. I'm like, this is exactly how I felt. However, I had read Dr. Robert Morse's book about these detoxing symptoms, feeling like the flu, feeling like a cold. and I wasn't scared. That's like the difference.
Wow.
This time, that night at 10 p.m., laying in bed with aches and a fever of like 100, I'm like, I know what this is, and I'm not afraid. My body is not failing me. It's not telling me to go downstairs and find something greasy and heavy to eat. It's telling me to stay the course. I'm helping. I'm healing you. And sometimes it hurts a little bit to get better. And within an hour, my fever was gone.
Wow.
The headache lifted. I slept the next morning, still a little weak, still a little off. But as the day went on, I started feeling stronger again, more vital. That night, felt ill again, had a little fever again. I knew what it was, mucus coming up. By the morning, that was it. I haven't had those symptoms since.
Wow. I think it can be super common for people to have detox, experience detox. And I can understand why people would be scared. Like initially how you were, and then you were like, screw it. I'm going to have some fried food.
Exactly.
And the symptoms went away.
Yeah,
I can understand why people feel that way if you're it's getting bad scary. Symptoms. I was it's super fortunate scary. Because when I went raw, I was reading some stuff by Dr. Sebi in August of 2015 about
Dr.
living
Sebi.
Foods, electric food. And that is what triggered me to go raw. So the next day I went all raw and it was literally like the best day of my life. I felt better than I'd ever felt by the afternoon of the first day. Even my husband was like, wow, like I see such a difference in you. And I felt like this huge weight had been lifted and I was introduced to myself for the first time and how I was meant to truly feel. And I was like, wow, I never even felt like this on any high with like any drugs or alcohol. I was like, this is what I've been looking for my whole life, to feel this way. How the heck can we feel this way? Like naturally like
all
this?
All the time. I love that your body was like, let's go. Mine was like, absolutely not. Absolutely
but I think
not.
What you experience is what most people experience. I think that's more common for people to have a detox, even for like a couple months. I think if it can be really long-term, maybe it's not detox, but I don't know. I'm not an expert with that. But yeah, so you did.
You mean like doing a juice, like a juicing fast long-term?
No, I mean like if people have detox symptoms for like a couple years,
I
don't know how
I've definitely read about people having at least weeks, months long, year long. That would be rough to feel the way I felt those couple of nights, even with the knowledge of what it was.
Yeah.
God bless those people. You know,
I know Shane Sterling, he said that he didn't feel good for like a couple of years raw. Now he feels amazing. I don't know if I would have had the patience to stick to something and think like it's working, so you juice fast, you did 5 days juicing. How was that experience? I know I did 37 days before and a couple 14 days, 7 days.
Beautiful.
And it is just when I'm juicing, I feel better than I've ever felt in my whole life. So how was that experience? How would you summarize it? What were the benefits? Was it difficult? And do you have any tips? Sorry to ask so many questions. Do you have any tips too for anybody who might want to stick to 5 days like that? Because I know it can be hard, especially the first couple days.
Yeah, I think the best tip, like I said, I move intuitively. So it was not planned. So probably planning would be my first tip. Like if you want to go into something like this, make sure you have your list together. What type of juices you want to juice, like want to create, why you want to make them, what you're trying, what part of your system you're trying to support. For me, I meditate daily. I have a chanting practice. I have this podcast that requires me to be fully present and clear, not just of mind, but of spirit, so that I can, like, my mind can be quiet so I can hear God, so I can hear love and let that speak. And so I need lighter living, and fruit seems to be that for me. And there was some citrus, I think was probably the highlight of the juicing. I bought some blood oranges and all the different varieties of oranges and grapefruit. I juiced a lot of that. I juiced ginger in every single bottle that I create. I also did a lot of celery, of course. I've been doing celery juicing every single morning now for the last at least 3 months. And we can talk about that later, but that's been a very positive experience. And I have everybody in my close-knit family, my parents, the kids, everybody is doing celery juice, and they are, I won't say they're enjoying it, but they're enjoying the benefits of it. I think that as you get clear about what your goal is, like the end goal. And like I said, for me, the end goal is lighter in spirit and in mind and in health. Once you know that, you surrender that to the higher power in your life. I call it love. I call it God. And then that brings everything else up, and it makes the juicing process much easier. It takes away the fear. Like the fear is removed. You get confidence. You get the courage and the dedication, the discipline to stay the course. It takes a lot of time to make the juices and to clean the machine, and then to make another juice and then clean the machine again, because you don't want that juice to like get into the next juice. Like it's a lot. And it's, like I said, my days are already so jam-packed, but it's beautiful watching this body, watching these hands do so much activity in the kitchen every day, just, you know, for the name of health, to keep my family and my body running in a way that is at its height.
Mm-hmm. And you're a very spiritual person. Did you notice the juice fast and just eating more raw foods and the fruits in general have made you feel even more spiritual and connected? Because I've noticed for me, that's actually one of my, that's not why I went into the raw vegan lifestyle. I was trying to reverse health problems and feel my best. But yeah, it makes me feel much more spiritual and connected. And that's one of the main reasons I stay on it, and just so full of energy and so much more connected to God and synchronicities and things like that.
Yeah, I definitely, the connection for me is stable. So no matter what I'm eating, this presence that I've been aware of steadily since 2013, it's there. However, when I don't have to use bandwidth to think about what do I need to cook for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, you know, that clearing out that space where I know, oh, I have 6 juices or 4 juices that are made already in the fridge that I did this morning. To have that bandwidth cleared, it makes it easier, it seems, to just be in spirit, to be in presence. I'm not using as much mental stuff. There's not as much mental noise with all the planning, because that is taken care of itself. The exercising now is happening, you know, like I said, as that it's all rising together, and it's a powerful feeling. I shared this before on Good Mornings with Curly Nikki, and I get a lot of people that write in about fear, especially like fear of public speaking, fear of being in front, you know, of crowds, in front of groups. And you feel that fully. And so if you have this overwhelming fear of even just health, like death, becoming sick, being afraid of like these terrible diseases that you hear about every time you get on Instagram in your feed, you're looking at like a funny cat video one moment, and then you see some celebrity has passed away from some devastating disease. Some young person has died of some devastating disease, and the next scroll to see that, and you're inundated with that all day. To be able to feel that and to surrender it and to feel love, to say love is here too.
Mm-hmm.
It gives you space to be able to make for those better choices, to be able to make themselves in your
life. Yeah, I love that. Well said. And you're so calm. You have such good energy. And I feel like a lot of us live in such a busy, fast-paced world these days with all the stimulation with Instagram. And I know I live in the city. It's like, go, go, go. I hustle and work all day. And then I'm mom at night. And it's just like, sometimes
for you.
It feels like there's not enough quiet time, but I choose that. So I can't complain about it. But do you have any advice for those of us just living such fast paced, go, go, go lives to connect more to God? Like, because I feel like that's so important.
It's like, I tell my audience, you have to wake up earlier. And I know that sounds impossible. I don't know what time you're getting up. Mm-hmm. What time are you getting up right now?
Between 6:30 and 7.
Could you push to 5:30? Like, as a mom, I know I have 2 kids. I'm also helping with 2 parents, you know, so it's a lot. It's a lot of work. But when it was November of 2020, I knew I was going to lose my mind and that connection with presence if I didn't start waking up early, because that was during the pandemic. Everyone was home and I had no time to meditate, no time to just sit. And my whole life is meditation. But when I say no time to meditate, to sit on my mat in silence, I didn't have the time anymore because I was too busy momming and being Nikki and being Curly Nikki. And so I started waking up at 5 o'clock, and my body was waking me up first. It was waking me up at 4:30, like every morning, and I would go back to sleep. And Rumi has a quote that literally says, don't go back to sleep. The dawn has secrets to tell.
Yeah.
I'm like, really? All right. So I started listening, and I got up and I started sitting at my mat, even though I was tired. I'm never not tired. I'm always tired. So I'd sit at the mat. And I started meditating at 5. And like I said, I have a chanting practice, a mantra practice. So I do that from like 5 till at least 6, sometimes to 6:30. And it completely changed my life in 3 months, not just inner peace, but outer peace, outer abundance. My whole life shifted. I did this great conference with a business partner that was featured in Teen Vogue and in People magazine and Forbes and like all these crazy places. And then the podcast idea, this daily show for Good Mornings, came out of the blue, like out of this nothing. It just came up so naturally and started within months of that. So rising early, and you do that by setting your phone alarm and setting it away from your bed. That way you have to get up and walk to it and then keep walking after you turn it off to go and sit and meditate, or keep walking. If you want to go and get on the treadmill, you can do a walking meditation. You can go sit outside. You have to get up before the rest of your house gets up. You have to get up before the rest of your life gets up so that you can be without being human for a while. And then that sets you up for a completely different day. And when you have a completely different day, you start living a completely different life. Everything will change, I promise you. But don't get up at 5 and scroll your phone. Like that, yeah, will be right back where you were. And I'm saying that from experience. There's times, yeah, like I get into those, you know, phases where I get up, the alarm goes off, and next thing I know, it's like 30 minutes later and I'm still scrolling. And it's like, what are you doing? Even if you have an excuse, like, well, I needed to get this email. No, that's your time, not world time. You're looking beyond the world. You have to look past this illusion at all times, but especially during that time. This doesn't exist. For that hour, there is no world. There is no you. There's no meditator, really. There's no, yeah, chant. There's no practice. There's just presence. And you dissolve in that, you get lost in that. And then presence opens its eyes as you, and then it chooses juice and a smoothie for breakfast.
It's like a domino effect. That's what I say. It's like, you know, it's like a domino effect. So starting your day like that, then it's like leads to one greater habit and a greater habit. Exactly. Like you said, and then the juice, and then the raw foods, and then the working out, and then the positive relationships and consuming,
right,
positive
better
content.
Better turning on.
Yeah, it's such a big difference. I think it's so key how we start our day. I think it's so underrated. I think it is so key to get a good night's sleep and to start your day quiet, because it's such a difference for me if I wake up on my own refreshed and have like some moments of quiet before I start my day versus if I'm being woken up by my kids or like some craziness, and then you have to get right into it right away without any silence. So how does your morning routine look? Because I think this is just so life-changing. So I'm going to start this now. I'm going to start trying to get up at 5.
And I'm going to check on you. I'm going to check on you because I know I can already feel the testimonial. Like I messaged you talking about like how you've helped change my life with my diet. You're going to be like, Nikki, this has helped like so much with just the way I structure everything. No, everything is going
to
change.
I think I hear Mark Wahlberg gets up at like 2 a.m. to work out and start his day. Then like some of these, you hear these stories.
I can't do that one.
And I'm just like, how do people do this? I'd be so tired. So what time do you go to bed? And I don't know. What if I feel tired, right? Sleep is important too. So do go to bed earlier
if you're
going to
get up at
5. It
is very important. I do not. I try to. So when I'm on my game, I am in bed by 9, not necessarily sleep by 9. And when I say on my game, meaning the kids are in bed tucked in and don't need me anymore. I don't have to get back out of the bed. I'm usually, eyes aren't like sleep until 10, but I'm also, my day is so active that as soon as I like get into the bed and I know the kids are safe and fine, I'm sleeping like 15 minutes. I'll start an audible because I love to listen to my spiritual books. I don't get time to read anything anymore, you know, because I'm moving. So to have like the Bhagavad Gita playing, you know, or some spiritual talk playing, I'll set it 15 minutes and I'm out within like 2 to 5 minutes of playing that. So I'll say 10 p.m. 4:30 still, my body gets up. My body wants me up meditating at 4:30, wow, but I push to 5. And even when I'm tired, my body is like, we're going, we're about to get up. What are we doing? But it's like the tiredness is there, but this love is there too. And I know that, you know, time is an illusion, but it's limited seemingly in this plane. So we need to make use of it. And 10 to 4 are the hours that body needs to be asleep. The human body needs to be asleep. I get up at about 5 o'clock, go straight to my meditation mat, my little altar. And I get my mala, which is like your prayer beads, like a rosary in the Catholic tradition. I was raised Catholic. Still like, I'm going back to Israel next week. And I can't wait to just walk those grounds, Galilee, and I'll be in Nazareth. And I've been to Jerusalem before, but wow, it's a really powerful space to be in. So I get my mala and I pray on every bead. And there's 108 beads. And I do that 16 times around. I say my mantras. And then I sit in the silence and then I get up and then it's off to work. But the difference is that I'm watching this body work. So it's not Nikki is getting up from the meditation mat and walking. It's like, yes, Nikki is getting up, but I am the one that is watching Nikki get up and do the bathroom stuff and then do the kitchen stuff and then do the juicing and then do the raw foods and then do the exercising. The recording is a very specific process for me. I usually try to get that done between the hours of 6:30 and 8:30 when it's kind of quiet here. I live on the beach, so it gets noisy and it's kind of unpredictable. But usually early morning like that, I can get it done. And I need all of that time because I don't really, there's no plan for what is shared. I sit down and I listen. Like I just listen to the silence. And sometimes I even say that prayer, that line from the Bible, "Speak, Father, your servant heareth." And I'm not listening for a voice. I'm listening for this feeling of love, like that felt presence comes in.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's an idea that comes out of that, just like the podcast came out of that. Then an idea, words come out of that, and then they start flowing. And that triggers my memory about a quote I saw yesterday on Instagram. Then I'll share that, you know, and the person that shared that quote. And then it just flows and it's like woven and love is weaving it. And I just have to show up. And I show up every single day. And it's been like that for 2 years now.
Wow. And I feel
that's like the jewel of my day. It's my favorite thing to do. It's the purpose of my life, of my being, is to help people feel this presence.
And I want to talk about this love. Purpose in a second. I watched a bit of your Breakfast Club interview. That's one of my favorite podcasts. And you talked a bit about purpose, and I want to talk about that. But I just want to say, like, you're such an inspiration and you're really proof that people that live a busy life, and especially those people who have kids, it's like an extra busy life in some ways. Everybody's life can be, though, not saying that, but you're proof that you can be connected still and live a calm life. I have felt it's been a little bit harder to connect to God lately just because my life has been so go, 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 but you're really inspiring me. And I think it's really, really important how we fall asleep too, because I know we talked about when you wake up, it being quiet. But I've heard for our subconscious mind, it's so important how we feel and our thoughts right before we fall asleep. That's why I think they say never go to bed angry, or, you know, they say you're really like drilling into your subconscious and creating your life with how you feel before you fall asleep. That's why so many people say to listen to meditations, affirmations, those things as you fall asleep. And like, I always make sure with my kids, I try my best. It does not always happen, but we always try and have a really positive night before falling asleep. And you said you listen to Audible. That's what I do too. That's just the easy. I love listening to books on Audible. And you have had a lot of books inspire you lately. Are there any that come to mind? Maybe 3 or 4 that have just totally changed your life that you'd recommend to us?
Yes, absolutely. I was going to add to falling asleep at night, if you can, on your back, if you're not pregnant and you don't have any other type of breathing troubles, that is a really good position to fall asleep in, to just kind of be aware that you're putting the body to sleep, but what you are doesn't sleep. And if you can practice that at night, it's a really like putting the body down, putting the mind down, you'll start to be aware as you fall asleep. And that's like one of the highest meditation practices to attempt. As far as favorite books right now, I revisit the same books all the time because there's been several that have deeply affected me. The Yoga Vasishtha, which I believe I shared as well on the Breakfast Club, is a powerful teaching to Rama, which is a god and a king in the Hindu tradition. It is everything from the Bible and everything from the Bhagavad Gita taken to the 10th degree in one book. So I would highly recommend that. And I'll send you the link to the version that I like the best.
Mm-hmm.
For somebody that's just getting started in the space, Michael Singer is always a direction I point them in. The Untethered Soul is this 101, like spirituality, presence, love made easy. And I think my favorite line from the book is when he says that this presence is like an energy that comes in from behind. And when I read that, I'm like, that's exactly what I'm experiencing. So the reason why I revisit these books is because it's fun to see how other people are describing the same thing, because we're all that. Appearing as Michael and Nikki and you and everyone that's listening right now, you know, so to feel that energy coming from behind, and you only feel it that way because you think you're this, but after you know you're not the body, then it's just like an ocean of that. You're that ocean. So Michael Singer, The Untethered Soul, and just one other book, Joel Goldsmith. Christian leanings, have you heard of Joel Goldsmith?
No.
So if you have Christian leanings, I know we all come from different backgrounds, and I am, like I said, Catholic, but very, very, very much in love with the Hindu tradition as well. Joel Goldsmith was raised Jewish, became a Christian mystic, but knew everything about non-dual Hindu teachings as well. So he wove it all into this beautiful teaching that was inspired by Brother Lawrence, a French monk from the 1600s, who talked about the presence of God, practicing the presence of God. And that's been my life since 2015. Like, that's my whole practice, is not moving this body unless I'm aware of or as that love, like a felt. It's not a blind faith. It's a felt faith. I'm always feeling that. I'm always in touch with that. And it affects the words that come out of my mouth and the things that these hands do.
Yeah. Well, I can see why your podcast is so successful. You're just so in touch and so well-spoken. And what about purpose? I mean, for me, I found my purpose through going to a very clean raw vegan diet. I didn't really know or have any idea what my purpose was before. I wasn't creating a purpose for myself or anything. And I truly found that by eating clean. And I think it's just, I felt so good. And then I got on track with my true self, and here we are. So what about you? And do you have any advice for people who are struggling to find or create their purpose in this lifetime?
Yep. They have to get silent. That's what I had to do. Every time I find silence, first of all, I notice fasting happens naturally whenever there's about to be some change or overturning. So I'm curious to see what this fast is going to bring, because it always happens right before something. So you have to make the time, whether it's in the morning or in the evening. It's harder because you're so much more sleepy. But in the evening, if you must, you know, before bedtime, I do both because I have to. But you have to carve out time to just sit and not Google purposes and not Google what this person is doing and what they've launched. Get quiet and say, speak. I'm listening. Tell me what to do. And I'm speaking to that felt love. So it's like, again, I'm not just speaking out into space at nothing. It might look like that to some, and some might think that's what I'm doing, but I know it's a felt, true, genuine, real experience that I'm having all the time, like 24/7. And so I find that presence. It's like, I check my posture. I check my mind, which means I just hear the silence that's happening right next to the thoughts. In meditation, you don't have to stop the thoughts. You just have to notice the silence that's always there, even when the mind is thinking. And then I check for him. I check for God, for love. And then once I feel that, I say, speak. And he doesn't say, you know, do this, Nikki. There's no like booming voice.
I think we wish he would, though. Sometimes I'm like, just speak to me. Write me a letter. Tell me what to do.
I would love that. But there's a click of peace, of relief. And so you relax into happiness. You relax into your purpose. So that relaxing is your purpose. That's your purpose in that moment, is that relaxation, that relief, that God is here. God is here. And you still don't know what to do next. Not in that moment. You don't have to, because next isn't here. So you're in your purpose, which means your shoulders are down. You're breathing more deeply. Your face is probably smiling. And then an idea will come sometimes. Email will pop up. Maybe you'll get a phone call. It happens. And I can't tell you how it happens. I can't tell you how soon it will happen, but it happens. The more frequently, the more silent you get, the more your life comes into alignment. And when I say silent, I'm not saying you walk around silently like a monk. I would love to do that, by the way. I love silent retreats. I'm saying you're silent within. So there's not that inner chatter that's judging everybody that walks past. And it happens naturally. Like, you can't say you don't do it. You're just not aware that you're not doing it. There's judgment. There's like, oh, that's a beautiful, you know, this kind of tree or that kind of flower or this kind of person, or I bet they're a professor. You know, like, that is happening. If you can just quiet that, whatever situation is coming up in your life, if you can just not react on the inside, your body is still going to go through and do the things it does. But there's a place in you that is beyond every emotion. It's beyond every feeling. It's beyond every thought. And you're just staying in touch with that. And that's why I chant, even when I'm out and about, especially on days that are very busy, that are very taxing, to keep me connected to that place that isn't touched by anything. And that is my purpose. And it guides me to my outer purpose. So this inner relaxation, this inner quiet, this inner peace guides me to what is for me out here.
Wow.
It guided me to the show, and it's going to guide you, listener, to whatever it is you're supposed to do. You came here for a very specific reason, a very specific purpose, and your whatever it is that you are driven to research, whatever it is that you talk about constantly, whatever it is that you think about a lot that gives you joy, that you want to share, like, lean into that. But first, lean into the silence, and then lean into that.
No, the silence is huge. Like, a couple months ago, I was feeling a bit overwhelmed and I wasn't getting enough sleep. And it was just like, there was no silence. And I was like, you know what? Even though I'm not going to be as productive, I'm going to lay and meditate or rest in the mornings after I drop my kids off at school for a couple hours. So I did that for about a week and it was so life-changing. And it's weird. Some big things were just happening, like big, huge interviews that I'd emailed a while before and never heard back. They emailed me back when I was when I was meditating, being like, sure, yes, let's do it. And like things are just happening. So I think you're right. It's so key. Even though we
feel
like
it takes the brakes off. You take the brakes off. Everything is trying to get in at all times. I met Oprah in South Africa, not because I was visualizing or, you know, like doing all these crazy manifestation techniques, but because I was practicing this love and literally wrote in my journal, like, help me see that this love is all I need. Like the Beatles, love is all we need. Love is all I need. Let me see that. And within a few weeks of that, of just meditating more, practicing that, I was on stage with Coldplay in South Africa.
Wow.
It happens and it's not rare. It's not like the whole life becomes a miracle. You are the miracle. Once you lean into the silence, you'll be like, why didn't I do this sooner? But your mind is so entertaining to you. Like it keeps us convinced that we have so many things to be worried about and to plan for and to manufacture and to manipulate. And if we can just say, no, stop, just for a second, stop. No, I'm going to sit here. And this is productive. This is productive.
Yeah. That's so cool about those experiences. And you worked for Dr. Oz on the Dr. Oz show for, I think, 8 or 10 years, right? Did that start to get you into health more? And do you feel like there are a couple of things that stand out that you really learned while working on that show, whether it be like spirituality things or health things as well?
Oh man, you know, I learned a lot about myself during the time I was on the show because it was 2013 when I did the first show and I was still learning how to trust myself and to trust my voice and, you know, the knowledge that I had gained. And I was primarily sharing about hair and beauty, but more spirituality started to come through, especially towards the last seasons that I was on the show. I quit because of the podcast, that last season. They're like, Nikki, we need you out here. And I messaged Dr. Oz personally. And I'm like, I can't come, not this season, because this show has become my life and spirit is telling me that I need to be here.
Yeah.
And he understood. But amazing. Yeah, I learned how to deliver information in short packages that are powerful. That's what I think it prepared me to do. And I thank the whole team. It was the powerful female driven team. Like it was a completely female led team of producers. And they met me that day in 2013 and they loved me and they brought me back every season. They would message like, Nikki is going to do a great job and probably make our life easier because she's going to help us write the segment. And so I'd show up and we'd have a blast and I'd learn from them and they'd learn from me. And they taught me, I mean, the top producers in the country taught me how to talk. They taught me how to deliver messages and I'll be forever grateful. As far as health information, I've always been interested in leading a healthy life. And I was really only there for the beauty episodes, but it felt appropriate that I'd be around, you know, the health folks. And there's a couple of doctors that I've met that I still keep in touch with now, like Dr. Jen that I met from Dr. Oz. Hi, Dr. Jen, I'll send this. And just powerful plant-based techniques that were kind of seeping in even then, you know, when I was trying and I would be like, I was pregnant on the show at one point and was just getting lots of tips on, yeah, you need to eat dates. And I'm like, dates? And now I eat them all the time and understand the benefits of them. So
yeah. And that's great. It prepared you for speaking for what you do now. Cause I feel like each thing just prepares us for the next, right? Maybe we don't even realize what it's preparing us for. Yeah. And talking about preparing, let's talk about preparing celery juice. I know you said you did. So I'm interested to hear so you've been doing the celery juice protocol. I am assuming inspired by the medical medium, right? For 3 months,
Absolutely.
You've been doing it.
I just found him recently and 3 months ago. Yeah.
Wow. So what benefits? And then after that, I want to talk about the fruit fast. What benefits have you noticed with the celery juice? And you know what? How do you enjoy it or no? Have you gotten used to the taste and do you like it more over time or no?
I have gotten used to the taste. And so I am good at taking things medicinally that I don't enjoy, like the different herbs I've done. Like I've worked with traditional Chinese medicine doctors. And so I'm used to the game of you got to get this down because it's going to help with this or that. So I do not love the taste, but I don't hate it. And I actually look forward to it because I know that it's helping and it has helped me. My sleeping is more sound, even though I still sleep like a mom, you know, where I can just like sit up at the drop of a pin. I go to sleep at 10 and I don't wake up until 5, unless there is some kind of drama that happened during the night, you know, downstairs. It's solid baby sleep. Like I die at night and then I rise again in the morning. I also notice less inflammation. That's been a big one for me. My stomach has been a troublemaker since I was 5 years old, and they blamed it on lactose intolerance. And they're like, no, you're not lactose intolerant, just intolerant to everything. Like to this human life, I think generally, like I'm allergic to all of this world, this earth. And so I feel that my stomach has been much calmer. It's been quieter since I've introduced celery juice, and knowing that I have this international travel coming up, it comes to mind often. Like I have a travel blender, a handheld blender, of course, but I was looking at juicers and there's not really an option you can take to another country and expect it to work once you get there. And I'm already been scouting out juice shops that'll be near, you know, the church that I'll be staying at. So we'll see.
Yeah. And is it a 32 ounce that you drink?
No. Oh, absolutely not. My tummy's small. So I do 16 ounces in the morning and then I do another 16 ounces after lunch.
Okay. That makes sense. And if anybody's looking for a good juicer, I use the Nama. I love it. In my opinion, it's the best on the market right now. And it just makes really smooth juice. It's crazy because I used to have a different juicer and I actually had to use it for backup the other day because my Nama was all ready for me to take to another location to film a bunch of content. And I literally couldn't even drink the juice. And it's funny because I used that other juicer for years and years.
You're a juice snob.
No, it's crazy. And it had so much foam in it. And I was just like, how did I used to drink this? So if the Nama is in your budget, they also have payment plans. They're the best. I'll put my link down below if you guys want to save $55. It'll change your life. It's so good. But what are the main reasons? I haven't researched the celery juice trend completely. I think I'm going to after this. You've inspired me. I think I might try it for a couple weeks and maybe I'll make a video about that. So go subscribe, guys, so you don't miss that. But what are the main reasons people do it? Like, what are the main benefits they say that people will achieve from it?
Yeah, it's supposed to help your liver, like support your liver in detoxing, clearing out your whole system, clearing out your blood, clearing out your body of viruses that like viral loads, whether like there was a bug that came through our house not too long ago, and knowing that we had that on hand, I felt a little bit more protected. I don't know if it helped. It didn't necessarily shorten the sickness of my son, but he also refused to drink very much of it every day. I was doing more orange juicing for him, but it's supposed to lower viral loads, especially viruses that maybe have been in your system even since you were like a child, and also bacterial infections. So it's like literally clearing you out before you then take in a smoothie about 20 to 30 minutes later, and then the rest of your day. And of course, eating light and smart for the rest of the day as well. But it's like a good foundation to set you up. It's also hydrating for me because, like I said, I'm super busy usually. And in the past, it might be noon before I even get a glass of water because between the meditating and the chanting and then the recording and then like getting everything ready. Now I'm thinking about I need to drink and I need to eat things, and that can do a number on every system, especially your adrenals. Like I didn't know that I was like taxing my body so hard by, for me, intermittent fasting, which is what I was doing naturally and not on purpose. It wasn't for my body and my system. And there's some doctors, one of them that I worked with on Oz, told me that as a woman that has not gone through menopause, we should not be intermittent fasting to better support our hormones.
Wow.
So as I began eating now, just shortly after having my celery juice, it's helped a lot. I can tell I have better energy and my body is just generally less inflamed. I feel like it used to be like my back would be hurting me a little bit when it was time for bed. And now all of that has kind of eased off. Like my body can still support itself upright and not feel like I need a heating pad by the evening time.
Everything's just running smooth. So you start the day with that on an empty stomach. Is that the protocol?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
exactly.
Cool.
It has to be an empty stomach and you can't mix anything into it. So no adding like apple cider vinegar, like no doing anything with that. It's pure celery juice. And then 20 to 30 minutes later, you can do your smoothie that you talk about and then go about the rest of your day.
Okay. I got to try.
And I just do the 16 ounces.
I'm going to try it.
More.
I might try 30. I usually drink a 32 ounce if I'm going to drink a juice. So I'm going to try this. I'm excited. I like to try everything. I haven't tried that. I haven't tried water fasting and I haven't tried dry fasting, but I have done fruit fasting like you've done. And I do intermittent fasting, but I stop eating at 3 or 4 in the afternoon. And then I start eating again the next day at 8 or 9 a.m., usually around 9. And it makes me feel really good. But okay. So fruit fasting, I want to hear about your fruit fast. Cause I know when you messaged me, you said like you would just be finishing a fruit fast, and I did a mono fruit fast in the past. So only watermelon for 21 days. And it was so
cool.
Life-changing. I know. I think some people thought I was absolutely nuts. I would go into the store and buy like 20 watermelons. My apartment would be full of them. But it just makes you feel next level. It is fun to do that now and then. I love it. So you recently did a fruit fest. How long was it? What fruits did you do? And how was the experience?
Absolutely. So it was 2 weeks and it was mostly bananas and grapes. Like I said, I always incorporate oranges, but I eat those separate from the bananas and the grapes. I'm trying to think if there was anything else. It was primarily bananas and grapes. I love bananas. And the research that I've done on them, like every single teacher that I have found really, really, really recommends bananas as being like the perfect whole food. And so I went to the store online that's based in Miami, and they shipped me some burro bananas that Dr. Sabi recommends. And I had them for the first time, and they are, I can't They're even, good. Have you had one?
They're creamy. Like, I go to the Asian markets here and I get
nothing
those there.
To say. Oh,
yeah,
yes.
They're totally, maybe if, okay, because I did a banana fast once. I saw Freely the banana girl and I was like, okay, I'm going to try this. I tried it about a year ago and I think I only made it to day 3 and I was like, I cannot eat one more banana, which is not like me
because usually
I can
texture?
Eat fruit. And then I felt so good though by the end of the first day. Yeah. And when I woke up this, or I think I felt really good when I woke up the second day, I was like, oh, okay, maybe I'll stay on this. But yeah. By day 3, I was done, which isn't like me. I'm pretty disciplined, but it didn't work for me. But maybe if I tried those other types of the
bananas. Okay. Oh, yes, absolutely. Like, so those taste like berries and they're so good and they're meaty, you know, and I don't get the hunger pains. The only thing that I have, like if somebody's cooking or if I'm outside and I can smell a grill, I can feel those old cravings of, oh, that smells really savory and delicious and warm. And as soon as I grab a juice or I grab that banana and I'm eating it again, the craving is gone. The craving is gone. It's like me, the olfactory, like that smell brings back the memories. But as soon as I put something like with the juice to my lips, you know, I'm rescued from that.
And so how did you feel only eating fruit? Did you notice a big difference in how you felt?
Yeah, not so with the juicing, big difference. With just the fruit, not a big difference from going from plant-based to fruit. With the fruit, I did feel a little lighter, but I didn't have any detoxing symptoms like I had with the juicing. I would continue to be mostly, like, I don't like labels. I will continue to eat mostly fruit going forward as like the main staple base of my diet. My body likes fruit more than vegetables. I do eat vegetables, but I notice that it's harder for me to break them down. It's harder for me to like assimilate unless it's juiced or unless I blend it. Blending has been my savior because again, I like the time and just to eat a huge plate of salad, I'm not going to do it. Like I don't like vegetables that much to eat a huge salad. I need to blend it and drink it and know I'm getting it that way.
And how long did you do the fruit only?
That was 2 weeks. Two weeks. And I know, it was about 15 days.
That's a while.
Yeah. It was about 15 days. And then that just became the juicing. And then I stopped and ate a potato, a small yellow potato that was steamed
and it was good.
Bananas.
It was
so
That's
good.
Awesome.
I think my eyes like rolled like back in my head. They rolled out of my head.
That's so amazing. Good.
I
love
it. The only thing I was craving when I was eating the fruit only and then the juicing, I had started making avocado rolls at home, sushi rolls with nori paper and sticky rice. And I thought about them every day. every day. It just kind of go through my awareness and I'm like, oh, nori paper. I could smell it.
And avocado. So good. I love avocado.
I missed avocado during that time. But like I said, I think the fat in avocado can give me trouble sometimes. So I have to start monitoring how much I'm eating of avocado at every meal because I could eat several avocados a day and learning about how taxing that can be on the liver. Have to back up a little bit. So that is really the fruit fast to back up from the avocado. I could just like giving myself a chance to back up from the fatty fruit and olives. I can eat a jar.
Me
you
too.
Know, of the ones I can easily eat a jar. And
sometimes
I
do.
Like
sometimes I do. They're so good.
Yes, me too. It was Italy 2021 when I became an adult and started liking olives. And I could go through jars and
they're so good. They're like a probiotic too. They feed your good gut bacteria. And there many people don't realize that.
We're done.
Yeah, they're so good. And I think with fats, like you were saying about avocado, I think a lot of people notice they feel better with lower fat. Some people feel better with higher fat. Some of the raw vegans, I noticed a trend with the raw vegans I interview in their 90s, like Fred Bishy, Rick Lambert, they're like thriving. And I noticed a lot of them say they eat an avocado a day. I think that's interesting. I like to take.
That's good to know, though. That's a good excuse.
It's interesting. I like to take periods of time, though, where I eat no fats. Like, that's what's nice about the fruit fast, no overt fats. You take a break from them. You feel so clear.
Exactly.
Because the fats are harder to digest, right? So when you're just eliminating all that and eating things that are super easy to digest, like the juices, which are basically pre-digested, and the fruits, you feel so good. And I just did a video actually with a gut expert on how juicing affects your gut health. Cause I think a lot of people think you need to chew that, or maybe you're messing with your microbiome by not having the foods. And the video is
the fiber. I hear that.
Yeah.
Like, what about your fiber?
Exactly. I asked her all about that. So that video is so interesting. If it's up already, I'll link it below. Otherwise, subscribe. But this has been so nice. I could talk to you all day. I'm so glad like we connected. I think you're incredible. So inspiring. We will have to have you back. I would love to talk to you for longer, but I have back to back today. I'm interviewing Brooke Goldner next. She reversed her lupus with a diet. So I already talked to her about that, but we're doing a special segment just about oxalates because a lot of people worry about consuming greens and too many greens with oxalates and they think they're going to get kidney stones and all this. So we're going to talk about that. And omega-3s and omega-6s, because I've been learning so much about that and how it's important, I think, to keep your omega-3 ratio higher. And so much, so many of us, even raw vegans, keep our omega-6 ratio so much higher with all the nuts and seeds and things like that. And so I think it's important to have the balance. So I'm going to have a quick talk with her on that as well. But this has been so amazing. I love you. I'd love to have you back in the future.
I love you too. One
as well. Yeah, you have such good energy. If there's anything you want to end off with that you feel called to share, for anybody out there who may be struggling to find their purpose or getting quiet or meditating or anything at all, even if it's not to do with that, anything comes to mind, then absolutely do so. And if you can let everybody know where they can find you, and I'll link it below.
Yes, I would say right now, if you can, if you're somewhere safe, just close your eyes and feel your soul and know that you are your answered prayer. Whatever it is that you're waiting on, whoever it is you think you're waiting for, that one right now that's hearing this, that's listening, that's seated, you're the one, you're it. And all you have to do is keep coming back to this still point and leading from here, talking from here, working from here, reacting, responding to life from here. And you'll get to where it is, you know, you already are, you're already there. You just can't see it yet, but you can feel it. This feeling is going to take you there physically. So you can find me at Curly Nikki on Instagram, and my podcast is Good Mornings with Curly Nikki on Apple and Spotify.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Nikki. I think you're awesome. And to the viewers, I hope you guys enjoyed this. It's just such a calming, great vibe today with you, Nikki. And if you guys did, give it a big thumbs up. Make sure to subscribe if you don't already. And I'll catch you guys in the next one. Bye. Love you guys.